celebrating 125 years of Mountaineer football.
In 2007, the West Virginia football team entered the season ranked third for its highest preseason ranking ever. The coaches and players did not hide from the limelight. In fact, they embraced it because West Virginia is one of college football's elite programs, and the national spotlight comes with the territory. And while the Mountaineers moved forward on their quest to become college football's top team, they did it with a toughness and style that few teams could match. It was easy to take in all the good things, but how a team deals with the negative is a true sign of character. Dealing with the negative could actually be the brightest accomplishment of the 2007 Mountaineers. There were plenty of positives, but no team had to endure what this team did in the month of December. No team had more success, yet no team had more adversity. When the tough times finally settled, one team was left standing taller than the rest, and that was the West Virginia Mountaineers. They rallied, stood together, and won the biggest game in school history when no one gave them a chance. That is the true sign of this team's character. One of college football's bright spots in 2007, the Mountaineers finished with their heads held high and made their fans proud. It's Mountaineer Pride. The story of the 2007 West Virginia University football team is brought to you by United Bank. West Virginia opened the 2007 season at home against Western Michigan.
It's big to come out and set an example for the rest of the nation, too. And that was one of our keys, is not to come out here and take this game as an exhibition game or anything like that, but to come out here and make a statement from day one. And this was round one, and every other game would be just important.
The added pressure of being ranked third in the preseason had no effect on the Mountaineers.
You know, we're excited. You know, we went through those, two, 3 weeks of camp, and we were just ready to hit someone in a different color jersey.
To the 30, foot races on, he's to the 20, 15, 10, 5, end zone, touchdown, Steve Slayton.
The dynamic duo of Steve Slayton and Patrick White picked up right where they left off from the previous season as the two accounted for 8 touchdowns. West Virginia led from the start and never looked back in scoring the most points in a season opening game since 1988. On defense, the Mountaineers were stingy against the run, holding the Broncos to just 32 total rushing yards. Linebacker Morty Ivey led the way with 10 tackles, followed by Mark Megro with 9. The victory brought plenty of reasons to smile. In week two, West Virginia's non-conference action continued with the team's first trip to Marshall in 92 years. It was a hostile environment, but yet again, the experience of the 2007 Mountaineers came through. A slow start enabled Marshall to take a 13-6 halftime lead, but 42 second-half points by the Mountaineer offense secured the blowout victory.
There goes Pat White, 20, 15, 10, 5, end zone, touchdown, Patrick White! Snap comes back, handoff Slayton. He's got a hole. He's at the 15, running to the 10, running to the end zone. He's in, touchdown. Stevie Slayton takes it to the left corner of the end zone. He's in, untouched. Noel Devine punches one in.
We know how to get things done, and I think that is what happened. We got things done in the third and fourth quarter and came out with a win.
Darius Renaud led all receivers with a game-high 134 yards receiving. Slayton finished with 146 yards rushing. And Pat White added 125 yards on the ground and 149 yards through the air. On defense, the unit kept the Mountaineers in the game in the first half and was led by linebacker Reed Williams with 15 tackles.
We realized they were a tough team and they came to play hard, but we knew what we had to do, buckle down and just come and play them hard in that second half, and that's what we did.
Both sides of the ball contributed, and this win was the true definition of teamwork. Up next was a Thursday night showdown at Maryland. Both teams came into the game at 2-0, and the national spotlight was on.
It's definitely a game we were looking forward to, a big rivalry for us. It's the last time we were going to play them for I don't know how many years. I guess they tried to pull another blackout on us, but we came out of there with a big W.
Did they misfire in the very first snap of the game? West Virginia has recovered at the 20.
It's a big upside for him to come in as a freshman, as I did, and show what he has. I think he picked up things a lot faster than I have, and there's more to come from him.
The offense methodically chipped away at the Terps and finished with 353 rushing yards. The game spotlighted true freshman Noel Devine, who turned in 136 yards rushing on just five carries. The West Virginia defense stood tall on this night, keeping Maryland scoreless on eight straight possessions and holding the Terps to just 89 yards rushing.
No way. No way. I mean, there's some tough, hard running backs, and they never give up. And it was hard to actually realize that we really held them to 89 yards, but they played hard. They came out as strong. And I think our team kind of stood up, and that's where we showed the true dedication to what we wanted to do and where we were trying to go this year. And we went out there and we played a pretty tough game, but we pulled it out.
After that game, the defense believed in themselves, and I thought,
West Virginia was 3-0 and headed home for a matchup with the East Carolina Pirates. The past 2 years, it was the Pirates under Skip Holtz that presented a stiff challenge to the Mountaineers, and they knew that the Pirates would be ready to play. Unfortunately for East Carolina, the Mountaineers were ready too. Pat McAfee's second field goal gave West Virginia a 27-0 lead before heading into halftime. The onslaught was only beginning.
White fakes to Slayton, one-on-one with a defender, and look at Pat White!
I was going to try to get him to go outside and maybe cut inside, but I guess he was one step ahead of me on my first move, but I ended up getting him on the second move and beating him around the corner. Yeah, he definitely, he taught me that move, the 1-2, 1-2, go.
The defense turned in a dominating performance, holding the Pirates to only 54 yards passing and just 160 yards of total offense. ECU was held scoreless on 9 straight possessions and only scored in the game's final minute. On offense, Patrick White completed 18 of 20 passes and accounted for 4 touchdowns as the Mountaineers rolled with 599 yards of total offense.
They had shut us down the past 2 years rushing the ball. We busted out pretty big on the yardage there, and I think that was one of our top total offensive games.
In Game 5 at South Florida, both teams came into the contest undefeated and ranked nationally. The Big East Conference was once again in the national television spotlight. With West Virginia in town, the Mountaineers delivered a record crowd for a USF home football game. And early on, the two teams battled the turnover bug. With the Bulls taking a 21-3 lead behind 6 West Virginia turnovers, and with Pat White sidelined in the second half with a thigh bruise, the Mountaineers battled back. But in the end, the 6 turnovers proved too much to overcome. Without question, West Virginia is not accustomed to losing, but this team had a 24-hour rule. You let the loss hurt, learn from it, correct the problem, and put it behind you.
You know, we still knew there was a lot of opportunities out there. As far as, you know, the Big East Championship goes, we knew that, you know, we didn't play very well against South Florida, so that still would be there, and that was kind of like some of the focus, too. Don't worry about it. Let's just, you know, what's next? So let's move forward and forget about it.
West Virginia moved on to its 4th road trip in 6 games with a Big East contest at Syracuse. And from the start, it was clear that the Mountaineers had put the USF game behind them.
Schmidt's got it. He's in. Touchdown, West Virginia.
On 1st and 10, Robinson takes the snap. He looks. He dumps the ball right side, and the ball is deflected. Intercepted by Keelan Dykes. He's inside the 10, 5, end zone. Touchdown, West Virginia's Keelan Dykes.
I looked up, and all the ball just, you talk about something just falling in your lap. I mean, it just fell right in my hands. So next thing I know, I look up, and I can see Johnny Dingle like, big man, let's run. So I started running, and man, it was the longest 19 yards of my life.
Building a 31-7 lead at halftime, there was no letdown in the second half as the Mountaineers added 24 more points.
Fires a dart inside the end zone. Touchdown, Darius Reynaud!
Pat White was near perfect in the game before leaving in the third quarter with a sprained shoulder. And the legend of Owen Schmidt just keeps getting bigger and bigger as the fullback once again proved that he could do it all. The West Virginia defense held the Orange to just 94 yards rushing.
Pressure comes, he's going to get hit, and he's thrown down. Say hello to Mark Magro.
We got the job done, you know, again. It was great that we could refocus and get the win.
The West Virginia defense held the Orange to just 94 yards rushing, and the Mountaineer offense scored the most points ever on the Orange in the Carrier Dome. The results upped West Virginia to 5-1 on the year. Game 7 brought the final non-conference game of the regular season when the Mississippi State Bulldogs visited Milan Puskar Stadium. With a tough remaining Big East schedule ahead, it was vital that the Mountaineers did not falter against the SEC opponent.
Takes the first snap, fakes the handoff to Slayton. There he goes, big hole, 40, 45, midfield, cuts toward the sideline, 45, 40, 35, 30. It's a foot race, 25, 20. He's going to go all the way for a touchdown. Patrick White on the opening play of the game faked the handoff and ran 64 yards for the touchdown. Snap, play action, rolling out. White fires in the end zone, wide open. Reynard catches, touchdown. In motion, the slot man Hogan. Instead, they hand off right up the middle. Goes Steve Slayton. He's at the 20, 15, cuts to the outside. He's going to score six. And folks, that's the all-time touchdown record at West Virginia.
It's very important to me. I mean, I've broken a lot of records in my life, but I mean, the more they come, is it the more surprising they get, and then the better they are. And it was a great day for me and my line and my team.
Early in the second quarter, Mississippi State found itself down 31-0, and the Mountaineers were well on their way to victory number 6 on the year. The Mountaineer defense was outstanding, holding the Bulldogs to 45 yards rushing and 214 yards of total offense. The Mountaineers forced 3 fumbles and collected 8 tackles for a loss of 40 yards as they controlled the game.
That was really our motivation all season, to see ourselves as a total defense climb. So to hold another team under 100 yards rushing was real big for us, and it gave us a lot of motivation.
The non-conference slate was over, and it was time to set sights strictly on the Big East. At 1-1 in the conference, the road game at Rutgers on October 27th loomed large for both teams. The Big East stretch drive would determine the conference champion, and West Virginia wanted to be the difference maker. Rutgers had not beaten West Virginia since 1994, and the Scarlet Knights were fired up for the chance at the Mountaineers. The task at hand for WVU was to answer the challenge in a hostile environment and play hard-nosed West Virginia football. In a driving rainstorm, West Virginia answered the challenge and let everyone know that the Big East Championship still runs through Morgantown.
Handoff, Slayton, looking for a crease. Gets away from one defender, reverses field. Cuts to the outside, has a block. He's at the 30. Cuts to the 25. To the 20 down the sideline. 15, 10, 5 with a caravan. Leaps for the end zone, and he's in. Touchdown! And the ball is going to take a hop, and it's going to be fielded by West Virginia. Off of a Rutgers player, the Mountaineers have the football. Hands off to Rice, tries to cut it back. He gets hit in the backfield and dropped. Snap is back.
He did.
The kick is up, and the kick is over the crossbar, and it is good. High snap. White takes it down, fires. Screenplay set up for Slayton. Here comes Steve. Has blockers. He's at the 25, 30, 35 down the sideline, 40. Foot race, midfield, 40 of Rutgers. One man to beat. Third down and three. Here we go. White drops to throw. Fires wide open in the flat. Owen Schmidt makes the catch. First down. Leaps over the defender.
A guy came to tackle me. I was kind of not really thinking about it. Just kind of was a reaction. He didn't go very low on me or anything. I just decided to jump over him. It was real smooth. And so I was actually pretty pumped about it. The coaches have been getting on me not to do it because I got hurt last year doing it. So, but it worked out.
Patrick White was sensational with 300 yards of total offense, including a long run of 51 yards.
Patrick White zigzags down the field. Here comes Slayton, and he's into the end zone. Third touchdown of the afternoon. Super Steve Slayton scores, and the West Virginia Mountaineers build that lead to 30-3. He fires the ball, and it is intercepted in the end zone and taking it out. Here's Ryan Monday.
The Mountaineer defense came up big once again, holding Rutgers to just 3 points as West Virginia rolled. The Big East road victory at Rutgers was the perfect tune-up for the Thursday night matchup against Louisville. In two previous Big East games, the teams traded victories, and it was West Virginia's turn to host the Cardinals. The Mountaineers showed Louisville just how special night games are in Morgantown. And under the lights, West Virginia wasted no time lighting up the Cardinals.
Playing Louisville is becoming such a big rivalry here and big rivalry there. You know, it was important for us to get out to a fast start. Offense got us out to a good start. You know, Wicks was able to make a big play, return a fumble for a touchdown.
He loses the football. It's picked up by Eric Wicks. He's running down the field at the 30, the 20, the 15, the 10, 5. End zone touchdown, Eric Wicks. He recovered the fumble after Brom was hit.
When Coach Castile calls the defenses, he calls some great calls, and he called a field blitz from me and the linebacker and me and Johnny Holmes. And when we went on that blitz, he cleaned the quarterback up, and ball just fell out. And when it fell out, I said, touchdown, let's go. So it was a great play.
And Brom gets the ball, drops back, throwing out of his own end zone, fires deep downfield, the pass deflected, and it is intercepted by West Virginia. Immediately going down is Eric Wicks.
You know, everything worked right because everything was in sync. The defense was running the blitzes right. But, you know, Louisville still made some great plays. And, you know, thank God we got Pat White.
But Louisville battled back and tied the game at 31 with 3:05 remaining. Someone in the old golden blue needed to make a play. Pat White delivered.
Snap back to Pat. Pat sets his feet. He's in trouble. He's going to scoot out of there. Here he comes. 45, 40, cuts to the outside. 35 of Louisville. 30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5. End zone. Touchdown. He did it. Patrick White.
Well, my role was on the sidelines, and I was jumping up and down for joy because that little man was running. I'll tell you what, it's sometimes it's you just got to sit down and watch in amazement, and that's definitely what I have to enjoy on that play.
Right. relieved that that game was over and we came out on top.
The 21st-ranked Bearcats welcome number 5 West Virginia into venerable Nippert Stadium in what Cincinnati fans called the biggest game in their program's history. However, the Mountaineers were getting used to being the big game on everyone's schedule. It was old news to them.
Hand off to Ramsey, and Ramsey is just stuffed by Johnny Dingle. Slayton on a bubble screen. Look out!
Any play actions, option toss taken by Schmidt. He's into the end zone. Touchdown, West Virginia's Owen Schmidt.
Mark in trouble. Down he goes, and it was Mark Magro.
He's going to keep it running. Mark gets hit, stays alive on his feet. Loses the football, fumbled football. West Virginia has it. Ryan Monday recovers it at the 14-yard line.
White's going to run it himself. Touchdown. White. How did he avoid that and throws a perfect strike downfield to Jala?
The Mountaineers unleashed a running game that totaled 295 yards rushing and a pressing defense that had the Bearcats on their heels.
Snap back to Mock. Mock steps. Mock's in trouble. He loses the ball. It's a fumbled football. Mountaineers and Bearcats after West Virginia has it.
Pat White totaled 295 yards of offense. Steve Slayton racked up 103 yards rushing. And the Mountaineer defense chalked up 9 tackles for a loss against the Bearcats. Leading 28-10 in the fourth quarter, the Mountaineers caught the turnover bug that allowed Cincinnati to make it close at the end. But West Virginia walked out of Nippert Stadium with a firm grasp of the Big East Championship.
Gotta love it. Gotta love it, man.
And that game meant a whole lot to me. I don't think I could ever go back to the city of Cincinnati again if we would have lost that one.
With 2 home games left on the schedule, the Mountaineers controlled their own fate. The win at Cincinnati set up a game for the Big East Championship on November 24th at Milan Pushkar Stadium. The 20th-ranked Connecticut Huskies were the surprise of the conference in 2007 and came to Morgantown to challenge the Mountaineers for the league crown.
We were getting prepared to play a Big East Championship like we knew we would all season, but the team we were getting ready to play is not the team we thought we would be playing for the Big East Championship.
I think we were really focused for that game, and you know, we came out and just pounded them.
White's going to run it toward the end zone. He's in. Touchdown, West Virginia. And this is going to be fielded from the 11-yard line. Mountaineer special teams are there. Ball is loose. It's a fumbled football. West Virginia says they have it. They do.
West Virginia unleashed 66 points on the Connecticut Huskies with a 42-point second-half outburst to claim the league championship and BCS berth. Sparked by a swarming defense and 293 yards of total offense from Pat White, the Mountaineers captured their fourth Big East championship in 5 years. One game was left in the 2007 season, and it was the 100th edition of the Backyard Brawl against Pitt. Rivalries bring out the best in the underdog, and Pitt pulled off the upset.
I tip my hat to, I guess, Pittsburgh. They had a great game plan, and they came ready to play, and we did.
Sometimes things happen in life that you don't know the reason why, and you know, that was an experience. You know, hopefully that a lot of people learn from. You feel that in your gut, and you never want to feel that again. So hopefully, you know, just learn from that.
At 10-2, West Virginia represented the Big East in the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl in Phoenix against third-ranked Oklahoma. Ranked ninth, West Virginia was making its second BCS appearance in 3 years, and the Mountaineers set their sights on the vaunted Sooners. After head coach Rich Rodriguez left the program in mid-December to become the head coach at Michigan, Bill Stewart was named interim head coach and had the task of pulling the team together against one of the nation's great programs.
And for all these distractions to be happening at this time, it's just going to show our true test of our character and what type of team this team has really been all year.
If that's what he wanted to do, that's what he wanted to do. But we still, you know, got a ball game to play.
No matter what's going to happen, somebody got to show up in Arizona to play Oklahoma. We're going to go out there and give it our best effort and let the chips fall where they may.
Hey, we got a great opportunity. We've got a dandy out there waiting on us. Offense, play fast. Simon Free, man. Defense, swarm. Swarm and tackle. Punch that ball at every chance you get and keep busting. Special teams, lay it on the line. Attack your responsibility. Attack. We got to out-block them. We got to out-tackle them. We got to out-hit them and hustle. It's real simple. You out-block them, you out-tackle them, you out-hit them, and you out-hustle them.
Sir.
And you stay within the legal limits of the game. It's Mountaineer pride. Nothing cheap. From the heart. Straining. Damn, I'm proud to be with you. I'm proud to be with you. I picked you a good one, didn't I?
Sir.
We got a good one. We were going to out-strain and I'd hit these guys. Let them know. Leave no doubt tonight. Leave no doubt tonight. No doubt. They shouldn't have played the old Golden Blue. Not this night.
Yes, sir.
Not this night.
Let's go, baby.
Don't leave your wingman ever, ever, ever bail out on your brother. You help, you strain, and you just fight. Start fast. Stay on top of them.
It's a game, lad. Let's have fun and go get us a big victory.
With West Virginia leading 20-6 at the half, everyone knew that Oklahoma would make a charge. The question was, could the Mountaineers withstand it? Not only did they withstand it, but they counterpunched. When it was over, the routing was done by West Virginia.
The only way to interview Owen Schmidt, of course, is bleeding, because this kid plays so hard. Owen, I know that you guys were the only people in the country that thought you could do this. Did you ever imagine 48-28?
Not the score of 48-28, but I'll tell you what. I was watching ESPN today, and they showed a little thing about our game tonight in a poll, and the whole U.S. was covered in red, and the only state, the greatest state in the nation, was covered in blue, and that was West Virginia, and that's why we won this game. Overcame adversity, came together as a team, and that's why we won.
This is the last game you will be playing in a West Virginia uniform. The legend of Owen Schmidt, this is the final. How does it feel to go out like this? What does this win mean?
Man, you have no idea. Yeah, sorry.
What does it mean to you?
Sorry.
For what?
I love the state. I got a chance to play here, and this is awesome. This is the way I pictured it. I asked the guys yesterday in our team meeting. I said, boys, I ain't leaving out without that $1.3 million trophy. And they, you know, they promised me, and I can't thank these guys enough. You know, after what happened, this is awesome. This is awesome.
It's an honor to present the 37th annual Tostitas Fiesta Bowl trophy on behalf of our 3,000 volunteers to the head coach, Bill Stewart, the West Virginia Mountaineers.
Pat White earned game offensive MVP honors with 326 yards of total offense, along with linebacker Reed Williams' selection as defensive MVP.
You bonded like brothers. You were forged in the heat, man, in the heat. Nobody gave you all a chance. You guys stepped up to the plate. You did more than take a bat off your shoulder, lads. You guys hit singles, doubles, triples, and home runs. Hey! Don't ever forget this moment. You guys, I'm 55 years old, and on the backside of 30, as that old song goes. Don't be like us coaches to just keep going to next week. We're going to have to stop and smell the roses just a little bit. And I want you guys, like the 51 Dons, stop and smell the roses and love each other. Love each other. Now listen, we need to really praise our opponent. You just whipped the best football team in this country. Yes. You outquicked them, You know what we did? We out blocked him.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey.
Bill Stewart was named the next head coach of the West Virginia Mountaineers following the game. The month leading up to the game was trying for all, but the outcome proved that when Mountaineers bond together, nothing is stronger. It was a magical night for West Virginia University. Looking back at 2007, West Virginia football was once again a major factor on the national scene. The Mountaineers were ranked third in the preseason and stayed in the top 10 for all but 2 weeks, finishing sixth in the final polls. It marked the third straight top 10 finish for West Virginia, and the Mountaineers' three-year record of 33-5 ranks third best in the nation. WVU's Big East title was the fourth conference championship in 5 years for the program. Playing in their second BCS Bowl in 3 years, WVU has now won three straight bowl games and has gone to six straight bowl games with five straight New Year's Bowls. Offensively, the Mountaineers ranked third in rushing, ninth in scoring, and 15th in total offense. Defensively, WVU was seventh in total defense, eighth in scoring defense, ninth in turnover margin, 14th in pass defense, and 18th in rushing defense. Basically, the Mountaineers finished in the top 20 in just about every top offensive and defensive NCAA category. Quarterback Pat White finished sixth in the Heisman voting and was named the Big East Offensive Player of the Year for the second straight season. A WVU player has now won the award in three of the past 4 seasons. White was excellent once again, and the nation took notice as he was a semifinalist for the Maxwell, Walter Camp, and Davey O'Brien Player of the Year awards. White and Steve Slayton became just the third set of teammates to rush for more than 1,000 yards in consecutive seasons. And WVU's all-time rushing touchdown record now belongs to Slayton. Offensive lineman Ryan Stanchek and Greg Isdanner earned All-America accolades, while defensive lineman Scooter Berry and tailback Noel Devine earned freshman All-American honors. 10 Mountaineers garnered all Big East first or second team selections, and linebacker Reed Williams was a first-team academic All-American. And finally, who can forget about Owen Schmidt, the fullback that turned in big plays and huge blocks in every game that he played for WVU? He was the fullback who broke 10 face masks during his career because of his aggressive style. He was the fullback who thanked West Virginia for letting him be a Mountaineer, when in reality, it was all West Virginians who were honored. The legend of Owen Schmidt will live forever. As much of a success story the 2007 season was, it was also a major transition for West Virginia football. The Mountaineers were thrown many obstacles throughout the year, from dealing with the national limelight, handling adversity and tough losses, losing a coach, to staying focused and coming together. From August to January, West Virginia football withstood a lot of blows, but a resilient group of young men kept the program moving forward. An entire nation seemed against them. But deep in their own world, the 2007 Mountaineers knew what they were capable of. No team had more success in 2007, and no team had more adversity. The Fiesta Bowl is a shining moment that proves to never underestimate the strength of a Mountaineer. Now the transition period will continue into 2008. But the heart of this football program is still beating strongly. Veterans return to teach new talent what it means to be a Mountaineer and what it means to play West Virginia football.
And I tell you, if there's not a West by God Virginian out there that wouldn't be so proud to be a Mountaineer tonight, who's got the gold mine now, baby? Yeah!
It's Mountaineer Pride, the story of the 2007 West Virginia University football team, has been presented by United Bank.
About that time. It's game time, baby. Let's go. Let's go.
Hey, what's your
gonna slide back. They gotta fight this whole one out, homie.
This has been a presentation of MSN, the Mountaineers Sports Network.
Celebrating 125 years of Mountaineer football.